गुड मॉर्निंग डॉक्टर मुकेश सर, नेहा मैम एंड ऑल द सीनियर फैकल्टीज. आई थिंक एचओडी मैम इज ऑल्सो विद अस. गुड मॉर्निंग मैम.
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग मिस्टर विवेक.
ओके, सो टुडे वी हैव ऑल गैदर्ड हियर टू सेलिब्रेट वाइल्ड लाइफ डे. दिस इज 3rd March. We call it as Vishwa Vanyajeev Divas. And on this occasion, we are having 2 revered guests who carry in-depth knowledge and expertise on wetlands and livelihood. So this is the today's topic of discussion, basically. So Dr. Mukesh Dixit has served as joint director in EPCO and presented several papers on national and international platforms. He has more than 20 research papers, both on national and international journals, and supervised many of the research scholars. Sir is a professor of geology and is currently working in Sarojini Naidu Government PG College, Bhopal. We welcome you, sir. Our second speaker of the session is Ms. Neha Bhatnagar, and she is a project officer in Worldwide Fund India. And is a wonderful speaker. Ma'am is wonderful practical exposure in wildlife conservation, wetlands, and livelihood management. So thank you so much, speakers, for joining us today. And I would like to request now to Dr. Mukesh Dixit, sir, to just start up with his session, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Vivek. Very good morning to all the participants as well as the senior faculty members who have joined this webinar. I have served, as Mr. Vivek has said, that I have served as a joint director in Lake Conservation Authority, which is now merged with the Environmental Planning and Coordination Organization of Madhya Pradesh. And fortunately, we are having a good wetland here, which is commonly known as Bhoj wetland. So I have taken the case study of Bhoj wetland, and I am going to deliver lecture how the people are getting benefited from that wetland, and they are using it as a mean for livelihood. So straight away, without wasting time, I am just going to share my presentation. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, just I am continuing it. The title is Bhoj Wetland and Income Generation for Private Individuals. Maybe I am going to take the examples of government also, which is a stakeholder of this Bhoj wetland. So, we know what are the wetlands. So the definition is, as we know, that are the resources that interface between land and water system. They are amongst the most productive and biologically rich ecosystem, and are also amongst the most endangered wetlands, includes lake, ponds, mangroves, swamps, marshes, and coral reefs. Wetlands are complex ecosystems that are responsible for providing a wide array of unmeasured goods and services that benefits people. So basically, one should know that what are these wetlands? This is a definition from Wikipedia, so it is available in Wikipedia also, but the first definition I am just going to read out. A wetland is a distinct ecosystem that is flooded by water either permanently or seasonally, where oxygen-free processes prevail. The primary factor that distinguishes wetlands from other land forms or water bodies is the characteristic vegetation of aquatic plants adapted to the unique hydric soil. So one thing which is very important as far as the wetland is concerned, that it is very rich in biodiversity, and that is the thing which make the wetlands unique, in the sense that lot of varieties of flora and fauna, various species of flora and fauna are available in these wetlands. And you can say these are the repositories of these species, which are going to be, which are vanishing from this green planet. Now, What are the potential wetlands benefits and existence indicators? So this includes that what are the resources, forestry, agriculture, forest production. These are the resources which we get from wetland, and has suitable plant species, has high rate of plant primary productivity, shows evidence of uses. So there are a lot of things as far as the fauna is concerned, wildlife or fish production, which can these wetlands contains habitats suitable for wildlife and fish species, has a variety of water conditions and vegetation structures, has a large population of fish, birds and mammals. Maybe I am going to discuss these birds species in at length later on. Aquaculture is also one of the important part of it, which has a relatively stable water table, has a relatively stable water quality. These are the some of the things which are present in wetland, and has got a very high plant productivity and rich nutrient water. Natural products are also available in these wetlands as far as the mineral deposits are concerned, because the soil which is present in the bottom of any wetland is very rich as far as the mineral deposits are concerned, as far as the nutrients are concerned. So it is a natural fertilizer for which could be used. And one major important part is that it's the water of wetlands are a good source of potable water for the inhabitants of the nearby area. Energy production, it's an indirect one. Transportation is an indirect one. Recreation and tourism is also one of the part which is mainly responsible for the livelihood of the peoples of that particular area. And research and educations are definitely going on these wetlands, because they are the rich source of knowledge. Biological diversity is very important, which could be attributed as one of the characteristics of these wetlands. And cultural and historic values, along with the aesthetic values, are no doubt the characteristics of wetland. So what are the roles of life cycle of species in this wetland? And because it has got the plant diversity as well as the faunal diversity, it is of great importance and it is much in abundance in wetlands. That's why the wetlands are having a great importance as far as the ecosystem is concerned. So I have taken the Bhoj wetland as a case study. So a few of the things I want to mention regarding the Bhoj wetland project, and later on I will discuss about the livelihood part of it related to the Bhoj wetland. This is a good big lake which is present in Bhopal and is known as Upper Lake, and a small lower lake is also present, and both the lakes were taken into consideration during the Bhoj wetland project. It is a Ramsar site. We know that in Iran, this Ramsar sites were declared in the convention, and Bhopal is having more than 18, though it is mentioned here, 14 lakes of Bhopal, but there are more than 18 lakes present in Bhopal, and it is one of the major lake, which is known as Upper Lake. It is a picture of lower lake, not concerned with it, much about it. These are the salient features of upper and lower lake. The basic thing which I want to show is the catchment area, that is 361 square kilometer as far as upper lake is concerned, and only 9.6 square kilometer in lower lake. Both are having a dam, which is earthen dam, and the full tank level is 31 square kilometer submerged area, and storage capacity is 117.05. Maximum depth is 11.7 meter. So these are the some of the salient features, so that you may know the you can say it is only a physical way of expression of the extent of this lake. This is particularly the catchment area. It is an important slide in the sense because 361 square kilometer area is its catchment area. It just look like a lizard, and it is very beautiful lake present in the midst of the city. So every lake is facing a lot of problems. So in the similar fashion, this lake was also facing a lot of problems, out of which few of the things which are especially to be mentioned here are the reduction of storage capacity due to siltation, because a lot of silt was coming along with the flow of water. The spill channels through which the water get an outlet got choked due to siltation. And the very important part of it was the deterioration of water quality due to inflow of sewage, encroachment in catchment area, emergence of idols and taziahs during their festival seasons, and washing of clothes and solid waste dumping. Due to all these things, the flourishing growth of aquatic plants were becoming a nuisance for the lake. So this slide I am just skipping because it is showing the settlement around the lake. These are the few of the slides which are just revealing what sort of problems were there in lakes. There are a lot of disturbances. So I request all the participants to mute their microphone. So these are the problems. These are the pictures which are showing the inflow of sewage, washing activities, and bathing ghats and idol immersion, and drought in. That is also very important part, on the basis of which I have represented my paper in Sweden, and the paper was selected for World Water Week celebration. This is a post-monsoon session. You can compare both the things. Then this is one of the important part, that is trapa cultivation and boating. So I have just shown these slides that what sort of the problems were there in lakes. Keeping all these things into mind, the Japan Bank for International Cooperation, which is commonly known as JICA, they have funded the Madhya Pradesh government, especially the Housing and Environment Department of Government of Madhya Pradesh, which was the executing agency for the project. They have started the desilting and dredging with the help of these dredgers. They have removed the lot of silts which got accumulated in the bottom, and as a result of it, the water holding capacity got increased, and increase in the lake capacity was by 3%. This desilting and dredging was done with the help of the satellite imageries. They have pointed out the thing was carried out with a very scientific manner, because the hot spots of biodiversity, they were not touched, and only that area was desilted and dredged where there was less biodiversity was present. So the deepening and widening of these channels helps in the outflow of water from that particular reservoir, or you can say the upper lake. And the very important part was the creation of buffer zone, which was done by means of afforestation. It helps a lot in checking the anthropogenic activities of inhabitants of that particular area, so that they are straight away reached to up to the water, may get checked. And we have created a buffer zone of afforestation, where we have taken the full knowledge of the agriculture as well as the botanical part of it, and accordingly the A, B and C zone was distinguished, in which the plantation was carried out in a very scientific manner. This creation of buffer zone is very much visible here, that lot of trees are there and the lake is in between this afforestation zone, so that people may not reach directly to the lake. And the catchment area was treated with stop check dams, and these check dams have trapped the silt which was going to deposited in the lake. Promotion of organic farming helps in checking the pollution, the chemical pollution which was coming in a form of fertilizers which was used by the farmers nearby. And in the same way, the creation of a buffer zone, a road was constructed just to check the infiltration of human beings. And in a similar fashion, a promenade was constructed so that people can have a look on that particular lake and enjoy their health and get recreated themselves. So the fringe area was protected. All these activities were taken out just to check the just to protect the lake from the infringement by the or the anthropogenic activities could be checked. So the sewage was diverted, solid waste management was carried out, and the dhobi ghat got shifted so that it may not get pollute the water. And this is the picture which might be not very much clear, but shows that after rehabilitation, how the lake became clean. And these treatment plants, sewage treatment plants, STPs were constructed so that there may not be any mixing of sewage in upper lake. And removal of weeds were carried out regularly. And whatever the nutrients were, whatever the weeds were coming out, it was used as a manure as well as biofuel. So on one hand, the removal of these weeds, which were causing a great problem for the lake, is taken out and it is utilized accordingly. Few of the floating fountains were also installed so that the dissolved oxygen level for the aquatic flora and fauna will be available. And the fishes were also introduced in lake, as a result of which the various weeds were taken as a food by them, and at least 40% decrease in the density of weeds were noticed. The people were also made aware by various campaigns, and the diversion of idle immersion was the major mitigative measure by which the pollution in this lake was checked. And to impart the knowledge and to impart the main characteristics or main parts of the project, the interpretation center was established, which reveals each and everything through models and every other things in the similar fashion. Like here I have shown, these are the few of the models which were depicted in this interpretation center. So now I am coming, after all these things, after all these measures taken by Bhuj Wetland Project, and it was funded by Japanese bank. And when the project was over, the main aim of the project was to make the water clean and restore the beauty of this lake so that it could remain as a Ramsar site. But you know that these areas not only fascinate the people who are there and fascinate the tourists who are visiting to this lake, there are so many economic activities which are going on, particularly in that particular area. So as far as the economics of Bhuj Wetland is concerned, number of peoples are existent upon the Bhuj Wetland for their daily livelihood. The economic activities and cash transaction of these peoples have mainly been gathered through talks with them. These can be listed as below, which I have taken into consideration while doing work on it. The basic, or you can say the major chunk of it, are used by the fishermen. There are some 45 or 450 odd fishermen families whom we have contacted and just got the information that the many major Indian carps like Katla Katla, Lebe Roita, Clarius species, Serenus Megala, these are the few of the species which were present there. They catch these fishes, and on an average, a fisher may get at least rupees 1500 per month as they are earning from this activity. It is data which is long back when I was there. And since then, there are many changes in it, and their income got changed from 1500 to more than 3000 per month. Thus, the annual total earning at that time, it was realized as 81 1 lakh, the fishermen also pay an amount of 1 lakh as an annual lease amount because it is to be deposited in Bhopal Municipal Corporation. And anyhow, they have got 8 lakh rupees as an earning after all these doing things. So boating is also one of the major thing which is going on there. It is performed both by government as well as the local people. And there are many paddle boats, row boats, and in upper lake, and seven are in the lower lake. These boatsmen are also getting a lot of money from boating. And this is the slide shown here. And I'm not going to the statistics of it, that how many boats are there, how many persons are there, or many boatsmen are there, and how they are getting the things. But I just want to mention that it is the major source of earning for the boatmen. They are utilizing it, and they are getting this money from the tourists which are visiting this particular lake. Another way of earning, because I have said that there are so many stakeholders there. During the season, the strapa cultivation is also one of the source for many people who are cultivating trapa. Trapa we know in Hindi, singhada. There are more than 500 families involved in trapa cultivation, though it is going to cause a lot of problem in lake also, because they are using the fertilizers and they are in that way they are polluting the lake. Even then, as far as the economics are concerned, maximum 50 lakh rupees they earn as a amount from this trapa cultivation. Please mute your microphone. Yes, thanks a lot. So this is the trapa cultivation I have shown, and this is the boating, how the boating is going on. It looks very nice. And to have a ride in boat in upper lake is very joyful. Along with these specified ways of livelihood, there are roadside vendors, and they are also earning by selling the maize cob. There are sugarcane juice is available nearby to it. Seems to be very small thing, but it is the main source of their livelihood who are selling it. And snacks and cold drinks, there are various stalls. And it is polythene free zone, so nobody can use, but they can earn in any way. This slide is having some problem anyway. I am just telling you that horse riding also available there. So horsemen who are just providing the ride on horse, they are also earning a lot of money from it. Thus, the total income generation by private individuals through their income activities in the upper and the lower lake amount to is 2 crores, which is now these days it's more than 4 crores. So it's got just doubled in these 5 to 6 years. And a lot of other people who are, directly or indirectly earning from this particular lake are the farmers, which are earning or which are producing their crops with the help of the water available from this wetland. And the mineral rich soil which they are using is unparalleled, and they are also, their productivity got increased twofolds, and they are getting a lot of money from it. Apart from this private persons who are engaged or who are the stakeholders of this lake, the government is also doing a lot of things. The MP Tourist Department is using many motorized boats and cruise as a source of revenue generation from upper lake. If you get a chance, please visit Bhopal. And
I'm going to go to the hospital.
Please mute your microphone. Tell the audience, please mute your microphone so that I can continue. Only few slides are left. Is it possible to continue?
Right now, what Vivek is exhibiting the session. You can mute all the participants.
Hello. Hello, could you hear me, please?
Yes, sir. Sir, we are able to.
Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you very much, and sorry for disturbance.
No.
First, paused. So I was just telling about the boating, which was performed by, which is carried out by the MP Tourist Department. They have got a lot of motorized boat along with the cruise. If anybody is visiting Bhopal, please have a cruise ride also. It will provide a beautiful scenic beauty around the lake, and you will enjoy a lot. There is one cafeteria also from which the MP Tourist Department is getting lot of revenue, and the people who are serving
there.
Sir,
I just want to stop you for a minute. Actually, yes. somewhat you become a host, and various people are joining. So, if you are able to join,
okay.
He is trying to join the meeting again. So if you make the co-host to me or join the Vivek as well, or make the host me.
Okay, could you wait only for two or three minutes? Because the things are just going to over, and later on I will get them joined. So I have joined them.
Okay, sir. No problem. Okay.
So apart from cafeteria, a lot of canoeing competitions are carried out throughout the year, from which the revenue is earned by the government, not by the private people. Though some of the private organizations are also conducting such type of competitions, and whatever the money they are getting, they are providing the some of the part of it to government, and those organizations are also getting a lot of revenue from these competitions. And now these days, the Bhopal is becoming the hub of the shooting for these movies. So a lot of money has been already generated with the help of the scenic beauty of this lake. So the Bhopal Wetland Project, or you can say the Bhoj Wetland Project, provides many uses which lead to many economic benefits to meet the spectrum of wants and needs of multiple stakeholders, ranging from very tangible subsistence uses like drinking water, fish production, trapper cultivation, etc. And apart from aesthetic beauty and recreation, it could be seen that some of these uses are direct use with significant extractions like water supply, fish production, trapper cultivation. So the indirect uses also exist for entire population living around or close to lake, as it benefits from the complex ecological functions of lake, which supports economic activity and human welfare. Thanks a lot for the opportunity you have given to me to talk on this Bhoj Wetland project along with the earning or the livelihood which the stakeholders are getting from this project. Thanks a lot, and once again, I'm willing, and I just request the students or the participants who want to ask any question can ask up to whatever the knowledge I am having as far as this project is concerned and the wetland is concerned. I will try to reply all those questions. Yes, Vivek, is it you have seen? I have made you as an host.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes,
fine.
Sir, I can admit the students. Neha, ma'am, okay. You may please continue.
Okay, fine. Thank so you so I have given this job to you now. Admit the students, and please,
it's
and
okay, sir.
Please,
it's okay, sir.
Yes. And please permit me that up to what extent I will join, and later on I will quit from the meeting. Okay.
Sure, sir. Sure.
Thank you very much.
It's all up to
Thank
you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, a very good morning to all of you, and happy Wildlife Day. As Vivek has shared that today it's the Wildlife Day, and we all collected here to celebrate the Wildlife Day. Today's Wildlife Day theme is actually forest and livelihood. I feel ki wetland is also equally very important ecosystem. Which needs attention from the people, which needs needs some attention from the people, because people are not able to understand the ecosystem services which the wetland is share, which somewhat sir has shared ki how much livelihood a wetland can provide to the local individuals, to the communities. So I felt that it's become a very important topic that we should share with you all guys. What is the importance of wetland and how the role of communities come in wetland conservation. So today I want to discuss basically what is the role of communities in conserving the wetlands. And I will share my experience of 4 to 5 years where I have engaged a lot of people through various innovative tools, how they can also share their part in conserving the wetlands. So when we talk about wetlands, wetlands are highly productive and provide food, habitat to the wide variety of organisms, as sir has shared with us in his presentation. And it also opens a huge livelihood options for all the community members which stays with there. So in first slide, you are able to see a wetland. I just want to show this picture ki how this wetland is functionally very active. If you are able to see the picture, there is a highland stream which is entering in the wetland and which takes a lot of contaminants, sediments to the wetland. And in the wetland, you are able to see a lot of vegetation, lot of organisms like migratory birds, turtles, and various other species, wetland become a critical habitat for these wildlife. And then you are able to show the clean water, the polluted water get clean in the wetland, and then you are able to show the cleaner water outflow in the another stream. So when you see this wetland, this is a healthy wetland, which where all the functions are intact. When we talk about the importance of wetland, wetland is very important, and it acts as a cushion or it helps in controlling the floods. So whenever there is a monsoon season and when all the streams are full of water, then these water come from the streams and stays in the wetlands, and this wetland slowly the water outflows and it protects from the flood. Basically, first importance of the wetland which I felt is it helps in flood controlling and act as a cushion. Secondly, it also helps in groundwater recharging. So wetland helps in recharging the groundwater areas. It also act as a cushions. It also acts as a kidneys, basically, or the filters of the nature. you are able to see in the picture ki the contaminants are coming inside the wetland. They get cleaned through bacterial breakdowns and through these vegetations, and then a clean water get outflow. So it act as a kidney, it act as a filter for the nature, and provides us a cleaner water. It helps in carbon sequestration. As you are able to see, it's a highly productive wetland. A huge variety of aquatic plants were able to be here, and which sequest all the carbon and help in carbon sequestration. तो वेटलैंड्स को अगर हम देखें तो वेटलैंड्स के बहुत सारे रोल्स हैं जो हमें डायरेक्टली दिखाई देते हैं, और बहुत सारे ऐसे रोल्स भी हैं जो हमें इनडायरेक्टली दिखाई नहीं देते, बट इट बिकम वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. इट सपोर्ट्स वेरियस बायोडाइवर्सिटी एंड हेल्प्स अस टू बेसिकली गिव द एस्थेटिक ब्यूटी विच सर हैज शेयर्ड अस विद अस की बिकॉज भोपाल हैव अ वेरी बिग लेक which helps the communities to increase its aesthetic values, as well as it provides a lot of ecological ecosystem services to the city, to the city like Bhopal. But when we see during the course of time what happened actually, we are not able to understand the importance of wetlands. Or iski wajah se kya hota hai ki these wetlands start degraded. अब क्या होता है कि एक नेचुरल इकोसिस्टम है, उसमें इंक्रोचमेंट्स होते हैं, उसमें लैंड यूज चेंज होते हैं, उसमें डिफॉरेस्टेशन एक्टिविटीज होती हैं, जिसकी वजह से बहुत सारे रेनफॉल पैटर्न्स में चेंजेस होते हैं, जिसकी वजह से क्या होता है कि स्ट्रीम वाटर जो इनफ्लोज हैं वो खत्म हो जाते हैं, एंड आपके वेटलैंड में पानी आना खत्म हो जाता है. और जब पानी आना खत्म हो जाता है और एक्सटेंसिव फर्टिलाइजर्स का आसपास के यूज की वजह से, इंडस्ट्रियल इन्फ्लुएंस के एडिशन की वजह से, ये बैक्टीरियल ब्रेकडाउन और बहुत सारे अदर फंक्शंस जो होते हैं वो भी डिस्टर्ब हो जाते हैं. चाहे फिर वो बैक्टीरियल ब्रेकडाउन हो, चाहे फिर वो सैचुरेशन ऑफ कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड हो, चाहे फिर जो वाटर क्लीनिंग प्रोसेस है वो भी खत्म हो जाता है. इसकी वजह से जो वेटलैंड का डिग्रेडेशन है वो शुरू हो जाता है. एंड दैट्स व्हाई इट बिकम वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कि जो वहाँ के स्टेक होल्डर्स हैं वो वेटलैंड मैनेजमेंट में सामने आए. अब अगर हम स्टेक होल्डर्स की बात करते हैं तो स्टेक होल्डर्स वो सारे लोग हैं जो वेटलैंड से जुड़े हुए हैं और वेटलैंड के आसपास रहते हैं. इनका रोल बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है और हमें समझना पड़ेगा कि हम सब कहीं ना कहीं वेटलैंड के आसपास या नदियों के आसपास रहते हैं, और हमारा इंगेजमेंट टू वेटलैंड मैनेजमेंट और रिवर मैनेजमेंट बहुत ज्यादा जरूरी हो जाता है. तो अगर हम इम्पोर्टेंस की बात करें कि स्टेक होल्डर क्यों जरूरी है इंगेज करना वेटलैंड मैनेजमेंट में, इसलिए जरूरी है क्योंकि वेटलैंड जो है वो हमारी इंस्टीट्यूशनल कैपेसिटी और हमारा जो लोकल इंस्टीट्यूशन है, जैसे एनजीओज हैं, गवर्नमेंट्स हैं, स्कूल्स हैं, यूनिवर्सिटीज हैं, उनकी कैपेसिटी बिल्ड करना बहुत जरूरी है. उनके अंदर ये अंडरस्टैंडिंग होना कि वेटलैंड की क्या इंपॉर्टेंस है वो बहुत जरूरी है. अगर लोगों को पता होगा कि वेटलैंड की क्या इंपॉर्टेंस है, क्या फंक्शंस हैं, तो शायद हम उसे बचाने के लिए बहुत सारे एफर्ट्स लगाएंगे. लोग जो हमारे स्टेक होल्डर्स हैं अगर वो अवेयर होंगे इन डिफरेंट क्रॉस सेक्टोरल इशूज पे, जैसे एग्रीकल्चर पे, इंडस्ट्रियल और म्यूनिसिपल पॉल्यूशन पे, क्लाइमेट चेंज पे, लैंड यूज चेंज पर, देन वो हमारे जो मैनेजमेंट में सपोर्ट कर सकते हैं उसको कम करने में, वेटलैंड को कंजर्व करने में. सिमिलरली हमारे जितने भी स्टेक होल्डर्स हैं वो बहुत सारी इन्वेंट्रीज बनाने में हमारी हेल्प कर सकते हैं. Like they can help us in assessing the water quality. They can help us to make the list of biodiversity which is present there. They are able to help us to make the inventories on the threats. What kind of threats are available and present on that wetland. They also facilitates us in effective cooperation, communication, participation of different interest groups. And they also helps to, it is also very important that there should be a sense of belongingness among the individuals towards the wetland. This sense of belongingness helps to conserve the wetland. That's why the stakeholders are also helps or supports us in designing implementation of projects like management plans, various campaigns, various surveys, and etc. So I feel when we talk about a wetland, it's very important that the community should know about what is the importance of the wetland and how they can play a very important role in conserving the wetlands. So for this, what we can do is we can make the people as a mitra, a friend for the wetland, basically. I'm sorry, I'm not able to. So wetland mitras, basically nothing. The self-motivated individuals who are very concerned towards the degraded wetlands, who are dedicated, who wants to give their dedication towards the conservation of wetlands, who are willing to protect the wetlands, who are willing to involve various multi-stakeholder groups, which depends directly or indirectly to the wetlands. And also, wetland mitras are also those people who are contain some indigenous and local knowledge of that wetland. So wetland mitras are the group of people who are self-motivated volunteers who want to work towards the preservation and protection of the water systems and also wants to promote the community engagement in order to conserve and manage the wetlands. So wetland mitras, who are the wetland mitras? Wetland mitras can be anybody, all the peoples who are living along the wetlands, all the communities such as fishermen, boatmen, who derive their livelihoods from the wetlands, all the religious institutions, ashrams, faith-based organizations can be the wetland mitras, all the members of the panchayats and ULBs can be a wetland mitras, all the government departments at the district level, state level and central level can be wetland mitras, all the schools, universities, colleges, NGOs, civil society organizations can be the wetland mitras, or the corporate houses, industries all around. And all the students like NCC, NSS, ASHA, Aganwadi, sanitation workers, they all can be a wetland mitra and can play a very important role in conserving these wetlands. So what there is a very very simple form available online in MOFCC where you can become a wetland mitra and you can pledge to contribute the efforts to maintain the wetland pristine and clean. You can pledge to strive to keep our wetlands free from polythene, e-waste and other pollutants. You can pledge to conserve the aquatic biodiversity of that wetland and neither let ourselves or anybody else to pollute our wetlands. You can pledge also to provide a new life to your wetland and becoming a wetland mitra. So this form is available at MOFCC site and anybody can participate and help the governments to conserve the wetlands which are present nearby your areas. So when you see the role of mitras can help in three main pillars. First is the sensitization and mobilization. These mitras can help to sensitize and mobilize various community members and try to bring the awareness among the communities. This is the first pillar which they can play a very important role. Second, they can take actions for the wetland conservation. And third, they become very strong voices for the wetland conservation. So when a mitra is sensitized and mobilized, they can conduct various campaigns and outreach. And through campaigns and outreach, they can avail a large masses of individuals about the importance of wetland, why it is important, why wetland should be conserved, what are the functions which they are playing. In second pillar, if these mitras take the actions for the wetland initiatives, various conservation initiatives can be taken place, very easy and simple ones, which can play a very important role in conserving these wetlands. And third, you can help in policy and advocacy when huge mass of about 100 and 200 peoples raise their voices towards any conservation initiative, it becomes very effective and our governments also start working towards policy and advocacy and plays a very important role in conserving these wetlands. So I am sharing some of the examples and some of the tools which we can innovatively use to engage the community members. The first example that we can easily conduct a rally. I will share one example. There is a Kunigal wetland, which is present in Karnataka. This is a cascade wetland. Basically, seven cascade wetlands are connected with one stream called as Nagini. The people, and it is distributed in 3 districts of Karnataka. So basically what people have done, people have conduct a mass rally, and in this rally he take the water from the Nagini stream and do the rally throughout the 7 cascade wetlands. 7 serially, basically 7 wetlands are interconnected with each other, and they take the water from the Nagini and pour it in all the 3 wetlands in order to showcase that this complete system, these cascade wetlands and the river, is connected to each other. And it's very important that we should the connectivity of these ecosystems for the conservation of wetland. And this rally engaged around 1500 to 2000 peoples of the Karnataka, and it became a mass movement. A simple rally can create a coven, can create a mass awareness among the individuals. And this is the best example where around 2000 people interacted through the rally and become the mitras and become the friends for their own wetlands. Another example of communication and outreach is you can conduct the street plays. Various street plays can be conducted, and various people can be aware through the street plays. And I have given one example. There is one wetland called Madiwala wetland at Karnataka, where local people or the local communities get aware about the current poor conditions of the wetland through street plays. And a very good response coming out from this street plays, various people interacted and become the mitras and start availing their own communities. So this is also a very very good tool through which you can reach out to a large masses. Another very good exercise which we can do in wetlands is a word watching exercises in order to understand various stakeholders that each and every wetland, you are able to see migratory birds, you are able to see a rich biodiversity that is present in the wetland. And through bird watching exercises, you can create interest among the individuals, among the students, among the various communities. Such kind of species you are able to see in the wetland. And when the people see these bird diversity in the wetlands, the interest initially created, and they start taking care of their wetlands, start understanding the importance of the wetland. Another communication and outreach activity which individuals can conduct is the small meetings, small chapals with the farmers, with the fishermen communities, and try to involve these communities in threat mapping exercise, understanding what are the issues of wetland is facing. Through this small activity, through these threat mapping assessments, through these threat mapping exercises, very easily you can engage with the communities, and you are able to explain what kind of threats our wetland is facing and how our actions can improve or can reduce these threats towards the wetlands conservation. So like sir has shared the example of Bhoj wetland, and he also shared that there's an interpretation center there which communicates a lot of which communicates and do a lot of activities in engaging the people at Bhopal. So interpretation center also become a very interactive or innovative tool which can help the communities to engage. I have shown you two examples of two photographs. In first photograph, you are able to see the interpretation center at Kevladio National Park, and another one is the is in Hasinapur Wildlife Sanctuary. So these interpretation centers will become a platforms where you can make people understand about the concept of wetland ecology. You can explain them through panels, through 3D models, through interactive games. And you can easily make people understand how wetland is important, how wetlands function, what are the threats which wetlands are facing, and how much the community is responsible in increasing those threats. So establishing an interpretation center can help the community to understand the habitats of the birds, the lake ecosystem, and it can also create an interest among the individual to be a part of these communication outreach activities. We can also engage the communities through interactive games. Like you are able to see a Sapsidi game. So this is a normal snake and ladder game, which is designed in a way where the good water conservation practices are rewarded. And people are if the people are doing the good are adopting a good practices, they were asked to climb the ladder, or if their bad practices are discouraged, and they were if they are doing some kind of a activity which is consuming a lot of water, which is discouraged, and they were asked or they were bit by the snake and then they come down. So this is a very simple game, and through this simple interactive game, you can aware the communities, and you can also aware the activities which are good practices as well as bad practices, and you can encourage and discourage their activities by this very small game, which is called as snake and ladder game. So this is also a very innovative tool which can be used in communication and outreach. Another interactive game can be a water wheel. This is a wheel, water wheel, an interactive tool where you which talks about basically the water wastage and the ways how to reduce it, and how the people can adopt various small behavior changes in their lives and reduce a lot of amount of water. So through these interactive games, you are able to explain various individuals, various community members about how they can change their behaviors, they can adopt the good practices, and can contribute in conservation of various water bodies and wetlands and river. Another interactive game is this is an eco pyramid. This eco pyramid basically talks about the interconnection of different species which are present in wetland. So through this eco pyramid, you can easily explain individuals how the species are interconnected, how it is very important to have a balance between the species, and how if one thing if the number of one species reduce, how it affects the other species and how it affects the whole wetland ecosystem. So through eco pyramids, we can use this tool in communication and outreach, and explain the people how easily they can able to understand about the wetland ecology, about the importance of wetlands, etc. Second pillar, which I am talking about, the conservation initiatives which the individual can take, and through these small initiatives, we can also create a big difference in conserving the wetlands. The first initiative which I have talked about is cleanliness drive. This is an example of Madiwala wetland in Karnataka, where the urban citizens are performing a cleanliness drive around their wetland. This is a very small initiative, but can drive a large amount of people to come in front and take the conservation initiative in order to conserve their wetland. Another very small initiative which anybody can take is the plantation drive. The citizens can take participation in massive plantation drives, but we have to make sure that these plantation drives should be of native species. So this is an example from Bashetali wetland at Karnataka district, where the people have done a massive plantation, and but they have ensured the native species to be grow around the wetlands. So this also helps the communities to do a very small initiative or to do a very small activity, but it impacts a lot of people and it aware a lot of people that by plantation drives we can save our wetlands. Another initiative which we can do is we can survey the wetlands. So if I will talk about the Muradabad, anybody know how much wetlands are present? How many wetlands are present in Muradabad city? So it become very important to understand is there any wetland present in our city or not. So such kind of a mapping, such kind of a surveys can be conducted, and this will also create awareness among the individuals. Okay, our city is having 10 wetlands, and now मतलब इन 2010 वी हैव 10 वेटलैंड्स, नाउ इट बिकम 8 और 2 और 4. सो दिस विल टेल द स्टेटस ऑफ वेटलैंड्स एंड स्टेटस ऑफ वेटलैंड कंडीशंस इन देयर सिटीज. सो दिस इज आल्सो अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इनिशिएटिव व्हिच कैन बी टेकन बाय द मित्रास, बाय द कम्युनिटीज, कि वी कैन सर्वे, वी कैन मैप डाउन हाउ मेनी वेटलैंड्स आर प्रेजेंट इन आर सिटी, एंड दिस कैन आल्सो क्रिएट अवेयरनेस अबाउट देयर स्टेटस. So when we talk about the survey of wetlands, this example which I have shown you in this picture is of course from Moradabad. So Moradabad, there were Mitras, Ramganga Mitras, who have conducted a survey of 80 urban wetlands, and they assessed the status and the health of urban wetlands, what are the condition, and they made a report called Hamare Talab and Hamari Darohar. And this is very effective survey or report which helped throughout the government officials. They came to understand, okay, we had 80 wetlands, but all these wetlands are in very poor state. And most of their ecosystem connections, ecosystem services had been lost because these are under highly degraded wetlands. Another initiatives which individuals can do or participate in is can be bird census. If you have a very good wetland and there is a bird, migratory birds who are coming during the years in the wetland, so we can conduct the bird census, and we are able to know, made a checklist of the birds which are present in a season in a wetland. And there are various apps right currently available. On like there is a e-bird app through which you can make a checklist ki these birds are found in my wetland, and this will help other matlab the conservation management people to have those basically checklist ki, okay, these birds are we are able to see these kind of birds in this wetland, and this also shows ki the importance or the importance of the wetland, how much what is the status of wetland. Basically birds are the very good indicator of a good or a healthy wetland basically. So we can conduct the census. We can also conduct the wetland health analysis. This is a way to audit the water quality and health of the wetland. So from basically wetland health assessment is a small tool through which anybody can assess what is the water quality of that wetland and what is the health of that wetland is. And so if we want to be a part of some conservation initiative in the wetland, then we can conduct these wetland health analysis of the wetlands, and we can make the report on the wetland health and share with the governments, and all so that people get aware what is the health of the wetland currently is there, and if there is an alarming situation, if there is any bad activities which is going on, that can be shared with proof to the government. So this become a very very good innovative tool through which you can share the status of wetland to the departments, to the government, and important actions can be taken on the basis of that. So wetland health, in wetland health analysis, you have various tools like TDS meter, temperature meter. So you are able to see a picture where a girl is basically mapping the temperature of the wetland. What is the current temperature of the wetland? There is a TDS meter also there through which you can calculate the total dissolved solids present through a meter. Very simple meter. You have to give on and off. You get the reading, and very easy to handle. So all the people can easily handle and get the readings. Another important conservation initiative which individuals can take is, of course, they can audit their water consumption. Ki how much water? Vivek sir, it is requested, please, ki if there is another people waiting, you please just add them, because I'm not able to manage ma'am. Both things.
I'll manage. No issues. Please continue, ma'am.
Thank you so much. So what I'm talking about is the water footprint mapping. Through water footprint mapping, we can involve the local communities and help and directly share their contribution in conservation initiatives. So when we talk about water footprints are of two types. One is the direct and another is indirect. And when the people are able to understand their water, direct water consumptions and indirect water consumptions, they are able to understand ki at what points, at what spaces they are reducing, they are wasting a lot of water. So by understanding this concept, they may reduce their water wastage and helps in contributing the conservation initiatives towards the wetland conservation. So another initiatives which the people can take is a sustainable agriculture practices. Like the sir has shared that the people like 450 farmers are doing a trapa cultivation in the Bhoj wetland, but they are not doing a sustainable practices. They are using extensive fertilizers and pesticides. So what conservation initiative they can do is the is ki if the people get aware about the organic farming or how they can lessen the use of fertilizers by adopting a best packages of practices, this will surely help to conserve the wetlands. So this can be a very good initiative for the farmers to adopt the sustainable practices in various farming or agricultural activities like rice, wheat, sugarcane, or even trapa if the people are doing that. Another conservation for that we can use various tools which are already available with WWF for sure. We have made the package of practices for three main crops like wheat, rice, and sugarcane. Through these package of practices, any farmer can reduce their fertilizer inputs and help in conserving the wetland or a river. Another important initiative which we can carry out, which communities can carry out, is sustainable fishing practices. So if you are able to see first picture, in this picture, the communities are removing the African catfish, which is an exotic species in the wetland. And due to this exotic species, various native species are in declining position. So by removing this African catfish, these communities are playing a very important role in conserving the wetland. Similarly, on another picture, you are able to see the communities are releasing the fingerlings in the micro wetland of Kokra Bellur. This will help to increase the number of native species. And this very small initiative can help in conserving the wetland. Similarly, you can also help in conserving the habitat of migratory birds. This is an example of Kokra Bellur, where the farmers and the villagers of Kokra Bellur wetland, what they are doing is they are protecting the habitat of migratory birds. This is a very good place for painted storks. What they do is they build their houses not more than one story. Because after one story, there is the tree in on trees, basically, these painted storks lay their nest. So they what contribution they are doing is ki these villagers never make their houses more than one story. And this was indirectly helping in protection of the habitat of this migratory species. And what the farmers or what the villagers believe is that ki in jo painted stalks ka excreta hota hai, that is very fertile to the soil. And when these migratory birds comes to our villages and excretes, their excreta fertile their soil and help to have a good harvest or a good produce. So this is a very good example of a local community, how they understand this concept and how they are able to protect the habitat of the migratory bird by one simple step, that they are not making the houses more than one story. And this initiative can play a very big role in conserving the wetland. Another things which we can do is we can conserve do the in situ turtle conservation. in situ turtle conservation basically happens that basically turtles give their nests to the catchments of the wetlands or the rivers. So if we can provide a particular single space where we can make the hatchery in around that catchment and transfer all the nest of that area to that hatchery. And then when the eggs were transferred to the hatchery and after some times baby turtles come out from the nest, from the eggs, they will release back to the water systems. So what will happen ki by this initiative, you can save the numbers of the turtles in your water system. And these turtles plays a very important role because they are the scavengers. They can play a very important role in conserving the wetlands, in improving the water quality by removing all the waste from the wetlands. So I will give you one example in Ganga. In Ganga, we have the turtle hatcheries around Ganga, and in Madhab 1038 turtles have been released in Ganga, and in Ram Ganga, we have released around 102 turtles. And these all initiatives are taken by the villagers of Hastinapur, Firozpur, Bareilly, Sikandarpur, Patti, Muradabad. So this is also a very important initiative which can be taking place when the people are aware about these activities. And WWF have done these activities with these farmers or the riparian communities. And in collaboration with Forest Department, we have done this. And we have found that we are able to save a large number of turtles in Ganga and Ram Ganga. Another initiative which the individual can take up is obviously the water school program. This is a water school manual on my right side, in which various innovative curriculum activities are present. And through this curriculum, you can approach the students in a participatory and action-oriented approach. And this will create a sense of awareness on the existing water issues and also helps to give the solutions to the individuals at community and village level with a vision to improve the ecological health of the wetland. So under the water school programs, this is a unique educational initiative which can be taken up by the children, which is designed for the children to understand their relationship with the environment with focus on water basically. So this can be a very good initiative taken up by any school. I will share some examples. We are running water school program at Bharatpur, Harike, Meerut, Bulandshahr. And we have trained around 11,000 students around 150 schools. And we have made the eco-wash clubs in the school to promote the behavior change. This will surely help the students to understand and make the connections with their water systems basically. So by doing these conservation initiatives, we can help our departments, our government to form the management action plans. So wetland health assessment or various other initiatives helps us to identify the wetland threats, helps us to understand the wetland catchment, or we are able to make the people observe about their catchments, about their wetlands, and then by taking pictures of the site, by making the checklist of the biodiversity, by understanding their benthic activities taking place in the wetlands or the rivers, analyzing the water quality through wetland health assessment tools, we can get a clear picture of the major flows or the velocity or the health of the wetland or a river system, and can help the governments to make the management action plans. And this also helps to capture the community perceptions towards their wetlands. So these small initiatives can play a very important role in making report health cards. For example, if you are able to engage the communities on wetland health assessment, you can form a wetland health index where you can showcase ki, okay, the health of the wetland is, if it is in red color, so it's a poor health. If it's in a yellow color, it shows that it's a moderate health. And if it's in a green color, then it shows that it's a good health. So through joint actions from the government and from the local individuals, we can easily assess the five components of the wetland, that is the catchment health, channel flow health, water quality health, community perceptions. And this all can be used as a, all the data which has been collected under this tool can be represented in the form of an index. And this index can communicate the health of the wetland or a river. And it becomes a very good tool for joint actions and for policy advocacy. Similarly, the reports can play a very important role. I have shared previously as well, there was a survey conducted by Moradabad citizens, and we had made a report called Hamare Talab and Hamari Dharohar campaign. Under this report, we are able to showcase the current status of the wetlands. Basically, this is a report which had been published on 2014. So till 2014, nobody knows about how many number of wetlands are present in Moradabad city and what are the status. But through this campaign, through this survey, we are able to have a first report in which citizens map their wetlands and tell the government officials about, we have this much wetlands in your list, but currently we have only, like, there were 80 in number, basically in Moradabad city, 80 wetlands are listed by Nagar Nigam, but currently only 50 wetlands are left in the city, and the status of these 50 wetlands are in very poor condition. So it become a very important tool for the department of Nagar Nigam and district administration to take strong actions towards these wetlands. So these reports can also help in formation of management plans for these wetlands. So I will share one example of Bashet Ali as a case study, which I will share. What happened? So first I will talk about the Moradabad. So Moradabad, we have conducted this survey. This survey has been completely conducted by the local citizen of the Moradabad. We have made this report, and this report is submitted to the Nagar Nigam. And this report become very helpful for the Nagar Nigam to understand or change their status. Because according to Nagar Nigam, we have 80 wetlands in the Moradabad city. But this report tells the people, no, you don't have 80 wetlands. You have only 50 wetlands. And these 50 wetlands are in very poor state. You can't even say them as a wetland, basically. Another example is of Bashet Ali wetland in Karnataka. In this, what we have adopted our strategy is, we have take the multi-stakeholder involvement. We have done the on-ground practical implementations. We have take the community ownerships, and we have done the education and awareness. And all this, we also involve the policy and advocacy people like governments and district collector of that area to involve. So by the involvement of all these people, what a good impact have been done, I will showcase you. So this is a Bashet Ali cascade, basically. You are able to see there are four wetlands. Bashet Ali wetland, Arehali Gudahali wetland, Anekare wetland, Dodakare wetland, or Udakuntakere. So these are the four or five wetlands which are interconnected with each other. So wetland area is 19.5 hectare, and this outline which you are showing is a catchment of that of these wetlands. It is about 5 square kilometer, and the command area, the water facilities which are given to is 50 acre of area, and around 61 species of birds are able to see. This is a degraded cascade because it is not interconnected currently. So I will show this picture. If you are able to see, these all wetlands are near about, like Anakere and Dodakere is near about vanished. And if you are able to see a blue line, this is an old drainage system which is interconnecting with each other. But currently, these interconnections are not available, due to which all the wetlands are not getting water from drains and not interconnected with each other currently. So this has been identified, the problem had been identified, and various actions have been taken place. So if we talk about the wetland spread area, like in 1972, you are able to see that wetland is much bigger. And as the year passed, by 2010, the wetland area has been reduced so much. You are able to see in 2015 the wetland area kitna reduced ho gaya. So important action need to be taken if we want to conserve this wetland. Or we have also seen ki there is a reduced rainfall patterns within a years. Like in 2000 when you move 2000 say 2017, there is a reduced rainfall patterns. So this become very important if we interconnect these all five wetlands: Uddu Kuntre, Doda Kitre, Enakere, Arahali Gudahali wetland, or Bashatali wetland. It is important that we should revive the drains which are interconnecting these wetlands. And secondly, we have to do the plantation activities. So are you able to see the Basant Park Scouts and Guide Center? In this center, plantation activity had been conducted and the drains were again reformed and reconnected. So various activities have been done, like de-weeding, clearing the thick jungle growth, and other weeds had been in the water spread area of Bashatali had been done. Another thing, drain 1 and drain 2 are formed by making the slopes by desilting and clearing the jungle and connecting the drains between the cascade wetlands like Arehali, Gudahali, Keri, and Bashatali. By these simple three steps, you are able to see, I will show the pictures. First picture is, this is a picture of Bashatali wetland before rejuvenation. This is like engaging various community members, and the community members are showcasing the maps to the district collector of the Bashatali. How these wetlands are interconnected with each other. Another, they are sharing what are the major threats, how there is an issue in interlinking of the drains. What they have done is they simply planted the native saplings, about 1,170 native saplings, and all these saplings are 100% survival rate. And they are still survived. These plantations have been done in all the green spaces which you are able to see. Various water school program activities in the schools have been conducted. Are you able to see that water wheel? Various tools have been used. And then like estimation of bills and what kind of activity, what kind of initiatives to be taken have been approved by the district collector with WWF India, and they made a committee where the local communities are present in this community, and the forest and the department, government departments were there. This whole committee worked together and do the wetland health assessments. The government start desilting that area, start de-weeding that area. Active engagement in monitoring of the activity, jo interlinking ho rahi hai, jo khudai wapas ho rahi hai, jo miss ho chuki hai, jo drains khatam ho chuki hai, unko wapas re-deweed kiya gaya aur phir se khudai ki gayi. Un sab mein sab community members ko involve kiya gaya. So we are able to connect are you able to see that it's a before, there is no connection. Now we are able to connect. So we are able to make the drain around, and during the monsoon season, this drain is automatically start moving, start having a rainwater flowing in the channel. This is a complete channel which have been made on the upstream of Bashatali and joining drains of Arahali Gudahali wetlands to the Bashatali. So before activity, Bashatali looks like this. After desilting, it looks like that. So it's a before and after pictures. So in June 2016, Bashatali looks like this. In June 2017, when de-weeding and desiltation starts, it looked like this. And in June 2018, it looked like this. And in June 2019, it is completely filled with water. So this is a very small activities, like they have interconnected the drains which have lost, and they have done the plantation activities. These two activities protected this Bashatali wetland. And it is a very good example and inspiration for all of us that very small activities can do a great job or can help in the conservation initiatives of the wetlands. So thank you so much for hearing me in the whole presentation. And I'm really sorry for all the mishappening occur in between.
Actually, it was not the case. We had a patient listening, and actually it was very binding for all of us. Most of the students and even the faculty members, I don't know of them, but still, I was not very aware of these wetlands and livelihood that I learned today. Even sir had shared us a wonderful thought and wonderful work that he has been doing for past so many years. And hopefully, ma'am, we seek to again have some offline session once you are back in Muradabad.
Sure. So, I'm happy to involve people, students in various activities.
Definitely, ma'am. So thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much for your valuable time. And even sir, I think sir is not there. He has already left. So please convey my regards to him also.
Sure.
And thank you so much for this wonderful session, ma'am. We hope to seek similar such sessions again in future.
Sure. Thank you, Vivek, for giving me this opportunity to share the various conservation initiatives, which are very small, maybe look like very small, but can create a huge impact in conservation initiatives. The very small activities can do a thing, like boon boon se ghada badhta hai. So agar usko maankar chale, so these small initiatives can protect the wetland. And in Muradabad, basically, I want to share that there is a very poor condition and poor understanding about wetlands. There is no awareness about wetlands, and most of the wetlands have lost their inlets. The biggest problem in Muradabad wetlands is that we are not able to find the encroachments the construction have done in such a way that no rains, no inlets are available in the wetlands, and we are really in a very poor condition in terms of wetlands.
Ma'am, definitely we will be looking forward. So lastly, on behalf of IIC TMU, I would again like to congratulate both of you, and we are very thankful for such a key insight to wetlands and livelihood. Thank you so much, Neha ma'am.
Thank you so much.
We hope to see you again back. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.